Hello, everybody. We have a room full here, and we have people in New York and Washington. I'm Dave Schulz, and I'm pleased to kick things off today for this salon. I think this is maybe the seventh or eighth. The salon is an organization that hosts events that bring lawyers and practitioners and academics together to talk about current issues. It was founded by three lawyers, Lee Levine, Dave Skover, and Ron Collins, who have put this together. And it is co-sponsored by the Abrams Institute here at Yale Law School and the ISP. I'm Dave Schulz. I'm the director of the Media Freedom and Information Access Clinic here, and I'm pleased to introduce our speakers today, our conversants. We have two alums of the Yale Law School. On my left is Adam Liptek, who is graduated from here a few years back, was a lawyer for many years for the New York Times before he got a real job as a reporter. And he's worked with reporting now for about 15 years. For the last 8 or 9 has been the Supreme Court reporter at the Times. You probably all recognize him from his byline. And Adam and Floyd are teaching, of course, this semester here at Yale. And Adam will be talking with Floyd about his new book, The Soul of the First Amendment, which is just coming out. Floyd probably needs no introduction. As most of you know, he's the leading First Amendment lawyer and scholar in America, and the founder and the inspiration for the eponymously named Floyd Abrams Institute for Freedom of Expression here at Yale. So with that introduction, I'm going to just turn things over to Adam and Floyd and let them take it away. If you can't hear in New York or Washington, raise your hands. The sound is a little odd here, but hopefully this is going to work. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Dave. let me just echo Dave's point about Floyd's stature. When Dean Post gave Floyd the Yale Law School's Award of Merit, he said, and this is quite a stunning statement, but absolutely true, no lawyer has exercised a greater influence on the development of First Amendment jurisprudence in the last 4 decades. So it's a real treat to be here with Floyd. I was Floyd's student here some years ago, and then his associate at Cahill, Gordon, Rendell. And then we've talked together here several times, which has given me a real opportunity to bask in his erudition and wit. Let me give you one long ago example, which in a way will take us into the discussion. I remember being in a bar with Floyd, and the guy next to us was reading the New York Post. And he points at an article, and he says, I didn't know that. And Floyd said, why do you know that now? which comes a little bit into a series of the First Amendment. Floyd is a First Amendment libertarian, I think, whose basic idea, which was not controversial when I took his class some decades ago, but seems quite controversial now, is that we can let everybody say what he or she wants, and sensible citizens will sort out what's true, and they can be trusted to do that. And I want to ask you, Floyd, at a high level of generality, before we delve into the really terrific book. This is Floyd's third book. The first one, all three were good. The first, call it a collection of war stories. The second, a nice compendium of occasional pieces. But this is an organic whole. This is a real treatment of First Amendment theory and practice. And I want to ask you, Floyd, whether that marketplace of ideas theory of the First Amendment is still something we can be confident in, or are we instead or in addition just wary of the government as regulator of the marketplace, as censor?
Well, first, hello, everybody. I guess as I've moved along in practicing and thinking and writing about the First Amendment, I have moved more and more to the fundamental anti-censorial soul, as my book argues, of the First Amendment, which is another way of saying that, you know, whether free speech works or not in a particular situation or even at a particular time, that it is at its core in this country a protected species against the government.
And I distinguish that in my thinking about it from thinking more broadly, as scholars tend to do, about free speech itself. My book is a book which is First Amendment speech oriented, as opposed to an analysis of why we protect free speech, or the values, indeed, of free speech. The prime, almost the only value that I talk about in the book is the value of avoiding government censorship and the value of staying away from government coming down on free speech, free press. I would add, although the book doesn't deal with it, freedom of religion. But that's been the core of it from the beginning, when Jefferson objected to the Constitution as drafted in Philadelphia because it lacked a Bill of Rights, that his greatest concern and the expressed concern of so many of the framers was that there was this ever-present risk of governmental control, power, dominance, and the like over the press, which would remain unless we had a written Bill of Rights. I mean, remember, when people left Philadelphia, the only way the Bill of Rights had come up when they drafted the Constitution was for a 10-0 vote against having a Bill of Rights at the time the Constitution itself was being drafted. Not because they didn't believe in free speech or free press or freedom of religion, but because, at least as articulated, there was no need for it. That was the argument. We never said you could intrude into free press. Why do we have to go around saying that you can't? But really, led by Jefferson from Paris and some opponents of the new Constitution in its entirety, and others who were just wary of empowering a new federal government in a way it had never before been empowered under the Articles of Confederation without saying in so many words, Congress shall make no law, .. So that is my sort of starting point in the book, and it's my way of objecting or taking issue with many of the leading more liberal scholars and some of the more liberal members of the Supreme Court, whose views I might agree with on other issues, when they import into the First Amendment the notion that what the First Amendment is really about is making sure that the government truly represents the will of the people, which is something very close to what Justice Breyer has written. I don't think that's what the First Amendment's about. I think it is the result, a result, of having the First Amendment, is that more often than not, the government tends to represent the public, because if there's enough speech out there, it may carry the day in and out of the government. But a good part of my argument in the book is that we ought to stay away from that thesis as a core First Amendment proposition, and go back to focus on and emphasize the proposition that it is there to protect us from the government with respect to these particularly sensitive and significant areas.
And so the book does start with a quite convincing originalist account of this anti-censorial purpose behind the First Amendment. But what puzzles me, Floyd, if that's so clear and so obvious, why did it take the Supreme Court until well into the 20th century before it struck down a single federal law on First Amendment?
Right. Different modes of constitutional interpretation, absence of cases. I mean, it's not that there were a flood of cases decided against the First Amendment as we would now understand it, but that there weren't cases. There was a First Amendment there, which was rather often treated as hortatory, treated as an articulation of how everyone ought to behave, as opposed to law. And one of the most important things about the Bill of Rights is that the Bill of Rights are not just a series of admonitions. They are binding law. But of course, you're quite right that it took us into the 20th century, well into the 20th century. I mean, those great early cases or dissents by Holmes and Brandeis from the 1920s. We had the first great prior restraint case in the 1930s. We're really talking about the second half of the 20th century as the time when the First Amendment started to bloom and to be enforced as law with a lot of cases coming along. I was surprised that a session last year here at the law school when we had scholars in from around the country to talk about First Amendment issues, as we do every year from the Abrams Institute here, to hear one student about the same age as many of you here refer to the 1970s as the golden years. That was the time, the students were saying, when all this case law was created, all these cases were coming up. And if you start with New York Times versus Sullivan in 1964 and start to go through the Pentagon Papers and other cases into the 70s, I could see, although one never knows when it's living in a golden age, that's the way it's worked out. So that's not really an answer as to why, but it is a fair observation as to the reality of it.
You mentioned that this is a distinctively American idea, that other developed democracies don't have anything like this hardline attitude toward keeping the government out of regulating speech. And yet, many of those nations seem to work just fine, and there are significant costs attached to the American version of things. Why is ours different, and why should it be different?
Well, it certainly is true that I drop a line in the book saying that things in Canada aren't so bad, are they? You know, they seem to all get along, and people aren't jailed routinely for what they have to say. But even in Canada, you know, a religious zealot finds out in Saskatchewan that they're about to teach about homosexuality in high schools, and he puts leaflets in mailboxes, and he's denouncing teaching about homosexuality because they're going, in his language, to support buggery and this and that. And he's convicted of a crime. It is criminal. It is a hate crime. The hate speech is a hate crime in Canada, unanimously accepted by the Canadian Supreme Court. Now, you know, trying to think about our equivalent of that, the case I paired it to is the Westbury Baptist Church case here, you know, in which these people call them, religious fanatics, a family that styles themselves as a church, attends funerals of American soldiers who died in Afghanistan and Iraq, with defamatory posters and placards standing wherever the police will let them stand, denouncing the soldiers and saying this is God's will and it's good, it is necessary, and they deserve to die. We should celebrate it because the United States is too soft, as many of the placards say, on fags, that this is God's punishment. And so when the father of one of the dead soldiers sued, you know, we have a case. And what is it that Chief Justice Roberts writes for the court? He says this sort of speech is especially protected because it relates to public issues relating to homosexuals in the armed forces, homosexuality in general, how society should treat homosexuals in the public and private sphere. I mean, absolutely unthinkable as contrasted to the Canadian approach or the European approach. Now, you know, why is ours better? I think it's better for us because I think we have shown through our history tendencies to limit speech and move into highly anti-free expression modes, which very often start with mistreatment of minorities and move on from there through society as a whole. Now, I feel the same way, even if it were limited to mistreatment of minorities. But it seems to me that for us at least, we've, and again, all this is mid-20th century and later, we've made enormous progress and moved in the right direction by sort of gulping here and there and saying we're going to protect this sort of speech, even though we understand, as Adam's question quite rightly identified, even though we understand that it's going to inflict pain on people already suffering pain from their stigmatization in American society. But that's where we've gone. And so, I mean, to me, some of the more interesting contrasts in the book are language of then candidate Trump, which would be criminal in most of Europe, what he said about Muslims, what he said about Mexicans and the like. There's case after case in which in Belgium and England, where people have placards and the like saying Britain first, very familiar language, Islamists out, and worse and stronger language denouncing Islamic believers, call it, one case after another, sustaining the European Court of Human Rights, sustaining convictions, politicians banned for 10 years from serving in public office for using language like that. Now, our approach, I think, is bred most of all on the fear that if we start banning politicians from saying things, or the rest of us from saying things, even if they're deeply offensive and antisocial, that the effect of it as a whole is going to be a significant deprivation of freedom of a sort that all of us would recognize.
So you're a persuasive man, and I suspect a lot of people in the room are generally persuaded of much of what you say about the fear of government censorship until I say these two words, Citizens United. That's a case.
What's that?
Floyd argued on the winning side, and on this theory, right, Floyd, that you can't trust the government to decide even whether corporations can independently spend unlimited sums of money to support or propose political candidates. And a lot of people say that decision poses a threat to democracy, and there must be values on the other side of the free speech interest.
that outweigh this nice abstract devotion to speech principles.
See, if I were drafting a case, if I were teaching here and doing an exam, and there'd been no Citizens United case, I was trying to think of what fact situation would be most attractive from the free speech perspective. If I were thinking as a lawyer as well, what sort of situation would I really like to have up as the case in the Supreme Court to get the free speech side over the edge? I think I'd say, well, how about a documentary about the leading candidate for the presidency on one of the two parties who seems likely to be nominated, which is put together by a politically oriented conservative group that thinks that she, Hillary Clinton, should not under any circumstances be president. And I'll put in the statute that if you show that on television or cable or satellite within 60 days of an election, and any money that went into it came from a corporation, that would be a crime. That's what Citizens United was about. Those are the facts of Citizens United. And to me, I don't need any theory. I mean, if I were starting fresh, we had no First Amendment, and we were just deciding every case based on, you know, is this really the sort of thing we think ought to be protected? Not wacko religious zealots insulting and demeaning people, but somebody running for president, I would say, sort of, you know, John McEnroe, like, are you serious? You really mean that to be a crime? To put that on television? Well, that was my view when I became involved as representing an amicus, so I was one of the two people that got to argue the case.
You care to name the amicus?
I'm sorry?
You care to name the amicus? Your client?
No. No. My client was Senator Mitch McConnell, who, has also opposed flag burning amendments and the like. You know, it seems to me that, I mean, first of all, we know what academics think, but we know what the public thinks. There's really solid polling data where the public, on a bipartisan basis, with no distinction, depending on what political views people bring to it, 80% of the public think Citizens United was wrongly decided. One of the reasons for that, I think, is almost a strategic one. The Democrats hate it and have raised enormous sums of money hating it. The Republicans like it and don't think it's worth arguing about. So there's never been a big argument on the public stage where somebody was defending Citizens United, because the people that tend to, on the political stage, people that tend to think it benefits them see nothing in it for them to argue about. Now, Senator McConnell would, and he does care about things like this, but as a across the board matter, you know, it's been, in my view, crazily and I think unjustly defamed. And I think that Justice Kennedy's majority opinion in that case is a very serious and powerful First Amendment ruling.
Let me ask you about your litigation strategy in the case. You argued that the case was somewhat like, at a broad level of generality, New York Times against Sullivan, in that the court could have gone off on narrower grounds. It could have ruled for the Times in the Sullivan case on any number of grounds, say, other concerning. But instead, it chose to revolutionize constitutional law. And here, too, in Citizens United, it wouldn't have been hard, as you, even as you've set out the facts for it. This is a 90-minute documentary, not a 30-second TV ad. It's available on video on demand. That is, I have to seek it out. It doesn't assault me during the Super Bowl. It's put together by an advocate, in my small advocacy corporation, not General Motors. The court could have ruled on any of those grounds. Citizens of United could have won, but we wouldn't have this sea change, not in the sort of incremental way the law tends to develop, but this revolutionary way. The court bought your argument, but I wonder if you thought about whether there were smaller ways to win.
Well, let me say first that, as a strategic matter, the court has heard oral argument in the case, and then ordered re-argument, and made clear that the re-argument was at least putting at issue, as Citizens United really had not initially in the case, the continued validity of theretofore binding case law affirming the constitutionality of congressional action in this area and the like. So it was my view that, and I think a lot of people share this, that the court wouldn't have asked for re-argument if they weren't on the lip of taking the big step of saying that this case was wrongly decided and that case was wrongly decided and the like. So the strategic decision that I made was the only way we're going to lose this case is if the court came to the view that it really shouldn't abandon prior precedent, or that it should pick some more modest way of deciding it. And so it seemed to me that the only way to address that is to say, you know, sometimes when you really think that there's a major flaw in currently existent precedent which interferes with some or overcomes some constitutional right, you go and do it. I mean, you just do the whole thing. And that was what I was trying to say. You know, New York Times versus Sullivan, was a case which could have been decided on racial grounds. I mean, you read the record in that case. I mean, it's hard to believe now the way, and that Alabama case was tried in those days. Or it could have been decided on jurisdictional grounds. New York Times sold then very few papers in Alabama. Or it could have been decided, as I think Justice White came to the view, simply by limiting punitive damages and making clear that while states could continue as before in enforcing their libel laws, when you came to punitives where the big bucks are, either they were unconstitutional across the board or significantly limited by the First Amendment. So that was what I tried. Once a case is over and once the historians and scholars come to write about it and the law clerks leak about it and the members of the court maybe tell people about it, you find out more about what was happening, and there's certainly been a lot of writing since then to the effect that in Citizens United there was an opinion that had been written and there was great objection by people who became the dissenters that there had never even been serious briefing on the whole notion of throwing out pre-existing precedent, because as I said, Citizens United itself had not started down this road asking for new law, but was saying some of the things actually that Adam said earlier, that they should win because they were really a small public interest group, not commercial in nature, and that a lot of the factors that led to the court's most far-reaching decision on the other side, the Austin case, which the court overruled in Citizens United, that the factors there simply were not present on the facts here. But the court wanted to go further. I think it's not limited to first, it doesn't happen very often, but not limited to First Amendment situations where the court makes a decision that it's an ongoing juridical issue which ought to be dealt with at its core. They've come very close to doing that not so many years ago, very recently, in personal jurisdiction, when you can sue an out-of-state company under the due process clause. Just Justice Ginsburg writing a very broad opinion about that, which many lawyers just didn't believe. I mean, didn't believe she meant that in the same way that many libel lawyers didn't believe the court meant New York Times against Sullivan. It takes a few years after a great case, great whether one likes it or not, before the bar finally accepts that the court really means what it said. And that's commonplace.
That prompts me to ask about Reed against Town of Gilbert, another decision where people sometimes do and sometimes don't believe what the court seems to be saying, that all content-based restrictions are subject to strict scrutiny. Do we believe the court?
No, I don't think so. We'll see. I think they will adopt a more narrowing approach. But even if they do, I mean, bear in mind what it means when they, you know, when the court makes an opinion and there's a dissent or a concurrence which really takes issue with a central theme of the majority opinion. You know, you have to assume that the people who signed on to the majority opinion really thought or thought that they had thought it out and thought that the broad theme, whether it's jurisdictional in nature or First Amendment in nature or whatever, that the broad theme is one that they really thought was important to establish, even before perhaps they get to exceptions to it. And one of the things that has struck me practicing law for a lot of years now is how hard it is often for specialists in areas, you know, bankruptcy lawyers, when there's a great bankruptcy case about what court can decide what sort of issues, who simply can't accept it. I don't mean just emotionally. I mean all their training is that this is what the law is. And I mean, if have a look sometime, try to find in the stacks here a libel text written in a year or two after New York Times against Sullivan. They were describing it as a civil rights case in which the court ruled as it did because of that, etc., but not saying this case undid 150 years of libel law by federalizing, because it's just hard to accept. But that's what they did.
You see this in the federal circuit, where no matter what the Supreme Court says, they understand patent law and they're going to do it. So let me test the limits of this anti-censorship view of the First Amendment. I think it's easier to understand in the context of political speech, a little harder to understand in the context of commercial speech. You had Justice Breyer yet again just the other day in the expressions hair design case flagging this issue that different contexts demand, he says, a different understanding of the First Amendment. And Dean Post here has written about, well, certainly in areas of professional expertise, you may want the government to have some role in licensing and so on. Are you First Amendment all the way down?
I was here about say 6 months ago, Justice Breyer was here, and by chance, literally chance, I had occasion to say hello, and he didn't say hello. He said, "Do you really think a drug company has threatened the human life?" Look, I think you, the court tends to establish general principles and then look at the First Amendment outside commercial speech. I mean, we have a whole areas of people who have less in the way of First Amendment rights. Students in public schools, at least through eighth grade, maybe through high school, prisoners, people in the army. I could go on. I mean, there are whole categories of people whose rights are, by their nature, diminished and sometimes non-existent, in which you just can't cite ordinary First Amendment cases successfully. You have to cite army First Amendment cases the student rights cases. And I don't think that's irrational. Commercial speech, I think, is a really interesting area in which there will be a lot of development, and I think sooner rather than later. The real question is how far down the road or is the court going to go in the direction of, say, Justice Thomas, who basically doesn't think there should be any distinction in this area. So I'm on board for some distinctions where you're talking about professional expertise and the like. But I'd put it another way. I'm not sure how far Justice Breyer is inclined to protect commercial speech in general, let alone in these specific areas where you can more easily say that there simply has to be a level of governmental involvement in the licensing process, for example.
So your list of people who don't have full First Amendment rights, prisoners, students, government employees, gives rise to a question about whether the Roberts Court is a good First Amendment court, in your view, or whether it's a First Amendment court that is more inclined to protect powerful interests and less inclined to protect the powerless.
I think the Roberts Court is a spectacularly protective one for First Amendment rights. A series of 8-to-1 opinions in more recent years, they're really just sort of startling cases, stuff that, you know, when I was here, nobody would have thought was even protected by the First Amendment. You wouldn't have had arguments because the speech was so destructive, didn't serve any political purpose. It's simply pure harm, you know, speech like torturing animals and taking pictures of it, in which the court struck down a federal statute as it applied not to torture, which is illegal in every state and federally, but photographing it. 8-to-1 opinion. I won't even go through the nature, snuff films sometimes, torture of little animals, women in stiletto heels standing on little animals and killing them. I don't think there's a country in the world would think that anything such as I just described is worth even talking about. Whether that's what, free speech? Well, we say, if you've got a camera, you're taking a picture of something going on, however ugly and outrageous and harmful it is, or in the First Amendment ballpark, at least. Because in that case, the statute was viewed as overbroad, the court struck it down and did it, what should I say, willfully. I mean, they knew how awful the speech was, and they also knew that the speech, they know how awful the conduct was, the torture and killing of animals. They also knew that if you wouldn't allow the filming of it, you very well might not have the torture, because if there was no way to commercialize it, they might not do it at all. And that was one of the arguments made by the losing side in the case. But it is just an example when you asked about the Roberts Court and the fact that that was an 8-1 opinion is remarkable. Remarkable as compared to any other country, and remarkable certainly as compared to what I would assert the law would have been not that many years ago.
There is a school of thought that if everybody else in the world is doing it differently, maybe we're out of step. We're going to turn to your questions in all three places, New Haven, New York, and D.C. in just a second. Let me touch on one more area because I'm sure it's of interest to students here. It's not strictly speaking a First Amendment question, but it does reflect First Amendment values. Would you talk a little bit about the current controversies about campus speech and what a private institution should ought to do to ensure that people feel comfortable and safe and able to speak their minds and at the same time have the kind of robust debate that First Amendment values would like to ensure?
Yes, that's what they ought to do. A few thoughts. First, I do think that the events on campuses around the country in recent years have made college campuses probably the place in which First Amendment values have been most challenged in American life. Just focusing, for example, but it is an example, on the speakers who have been shouted down at colleges and universities. Just focusing on the university administrators responding to student protests. Take an example, Fordham University in New York, Ann Coulter, a former associate at Cahill Gordon. When asked to speak by the college Republicans, basically the university said she had to be on a panel. It couldn't be just Ann Coulter appearing there under somehow the auspices of the college. A disgrace, imagine. Absolute disgrace. These days, it's coming down much harder on conservative speakers. There was a time when the opposite was true. In the older days, it was university administrations, not led by students who had no power X years ago, but it was university administrations objecting to too liberal or left-wing speakers appearing. But it's a real problem. Now, I think that there is a distinction between having some sort of way for students, even though I hate the language of it, but minority students to have a place to be with each other, I think is not a bad thing, and I don't think it violates civil liberties. I think that a professor who chooses to say this depiction in this poem, in this play, in this movie, may be rough stuff for some of you because it's a very graphic rape scene. I don't think they're violating any broad principles, but I certainly do if across the range of a college or university, there's a policy of requiring or even strongly encouraging, in effect, warnings before works of art are presented or discussed or assigned or the like. So this is in part a difficult area because it is important for students to feel some level of comfort. The other side of that, though, is that education isn't always comfortable, and it shouldn't always be comfortable. And the non-negotiable part of this ought to be that there ought to be absolute freedom for ideas and presentations of ideas, however offensive they may seem. And that's just going to have to be worked out. And I hope we're going in the right direction. I mean, I see polling data sometimes of students entering colleges. I don't want to demean a generation, but
here goes.
They sure seem nice, and they sure seem to want to get along, and they sure seem not to want to offend anybody, all of which is good, right? But then when you ask them, well, do you think a college or a bar statements which have that effect, I don't know, should one be surprised or not, but you know, you get 40% saying yes. They shouldn't be allowed to say that. Shouldn't be allowed to say that because it leads to bruised feelings, or even worse, a feeling of being left out or stigmatized. So, look, some of these are hard and are some of them even insoluble, but there have to be some basic principles. We have to allow speakers on campus. We can't shut them up. We have to allow ideas to be presented, even if they're viewed harshly. When Emory College reacted to people writing in chalk, vote for Trump, and some students said they were traumatized by seeing the vote for Trump, I mean, you have to at some point say, you know, say cut it out.
All right, let's turn to questions. Maybe we'll start in New Haven. Yes, Becky.
Just going off of your remarks about campus speech, I agree with you to a large degree, but aren't we talking not necessarily about a new phenomenon of banning speakers, but a shift in the limits of acceptability? So, you know, 20 years ago or 30 years ago, it wouldn't have been acceptable to invite a Nazi that still advocated the extermination of Jews, right? It still wouldn't be. But we're just shifting the limits of what is acceptable, not necessarily creating a new phenomenon.
So just so that people in the remote places can hear it, I'm going to try to paraphrase, and I'm not going to do your question full justice, but Floyd heard it. The question is, aren't we just narrowing the limits of acceptability or shifting the limits of acceptability? It was always the case we wouldn't let a Nazi come on campus and argue for the extermination of the Jews. Oh, why is this different in kind rather than degree?
I think it's true that it's in the nature of our society and a public debate in our society that, you know, what was unacceptable yesterday becomes acceptable and vice versa, and that we wind up having arguments about things that we might not have even thought were subject to argument now. I mean, I've talked to professors who say the thing that they are prepared to talk about least is sexual misconduct on campus, that they just don't want to be heard talking about it publicly, because the on a risk-reward basis, there's much more risk than any reward. And so, yes, that does occur. So how do you come up with standards to deal with it? I mean, I think you do have to take account. It's all right to take account of feelings, you know, and find ways to deal with that at the same time as you don't diminish on a rather broad level of freedom of expression on campus. And there'll be challenging situations which will be difficult, and difficult in different ways as we change as a society. But all we can do is to establish general principles and then try to live within them, and then have our arguments about, you know, what's on the cutting edge, what's potentially not permissible here or there. I care a lot about the articulation of what's the rule and what's the exception. What are the broad principles that we establish and try to live by? And what are the hard cases which ought to be few, and to try to take it from there?
Dave Schultz, did you have a question?
Yeah, I was just going to take it in a slightly different direction. Going back to the beginning, you started out by saying, I think I heard you say you kind of disagreed with the notion that the First Amendment should be read more broadly as protecting democracy or having other goals other than answers. I just wonder how far you would take that in terms of, you know, things like the constitutional right of access, which is viewed as a structural component built into the law by the First Amendment, which doesn't have an anti-censorial role. It has a very different role. And do you just kind of reject that as outside of the intent of the First Amendment, or?
So I'm probably going to try again to repeat the question and butcher it in the process. Assuming the First Amendment is largely or wholly about anti-censorship, what about values like access to government information or the reporter's privilege?
Well, on access to information, I've never thought there was any sort of broad First Amendment protection for it. When Justice Stewart spoke here and said that the First Amendment is not a Freedom of Information Act or an Official Secrets Act, I think he had it right. Now, it is also true, fortunately, that notions of a need for access in order to gather information of public importance, you know, has come to have a level of First Amendment protection. I think that's, I mean, that's fine. It serves the public, and it is consistent with broad First Amendment notions. It's just not at the core of the First Amendment as I would articulate it.
Anybody in New York want to pose a question to Floyd Abrams?
I do. This is Wendy Kaminer. First, I have a comment and then a question. I want to challenge a little bit your characterization of the Roberts Court as extremely protective of the First Amendment. I can think of one glaring exception, and that's in the area of child pornography. And I'm thinking about the Berger case. I know that possession of child porn has been criminalized for a long time, but here's a case where a guy gets 200 years for downloading 20 images of child porn. The court won't even take the case on Eighth Amendment grounds, but it seems to me that you ought to be able to say, yes, it's illegal to possess child porn, but the First Amendment can still impose some limits on the severity of the sentence. I just think that's a glaring exception. The question I wanted to ask was, what do you think is the most effective response from a free speech perspective of the to the increasing dysfunction of the marketplace? You know, talking about the marketplace of ideas today, you sound like you need a little bit of reality testing. I haven't figured out a response to that at a time when people are receiving actual targeted death threats and rape threats over the internet, not offensive speech, but really actual targeted threats. And so much of that drives this drive to somehow limit whatever people consider hate speech. What's the response to that, to the dysfunction of the marketplace?
You want to try to summarize that?
You can hear that part, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
No, the Roberts Court hasn't had a lot, a lot in that area. As such, I don't know that. I mean, the notion that the First Amendment might come into play as a limit of sentencing in cases in which the First Amendment does not carry the day, as against the entry of a criminal conviction, as in child pornography, this is not a criticism, it's interesting as a possibility. I don't see the Roberts Court going there, and I don't see any court that I can now think of going there. But it's a valuable and for me it's a thought that I had not previously considered. More broadly, in terms of the direction of the court in the area that you adverted to, I have to say there are First Amendment decisions of the Roberts Court that I don't agree with, to take the Holder case under the Obama administration, a broad statute designed to prevent terrorism, which winds up having the effect of preventing or criminalizing the activity of a public interest group that is dealing with a group which is designated as terrorists, but only with respect to teaching them how to engage in advocacy in front of the United Nations, for example. I thought that was a closer case than most of my friends in what I'll call the First Amendment bar. I do think that the fact of the case, the nature of the speech in the case was such that it should have been held protected speech. And there were other areas as well in which you raised, an interesting example, but it doesn't diminish for me the sort of broad conclusion that I offered about the degree to which the court has exhibited a significant and often by lopsided votes devoted protection of First Amendment interests.
How about in Washington? Any questions from the District of Columbia? Yes, in the back.
Hi, this is Laura Handman. Hi. In Washington, the word of the day is leaks. And the government has ways of punishing reporters that are not necessarily prosecuting them for libel, but putting them in jail for refusing to disclose confidential sources. And as you know, there haven't been cases in modern history, at least, where reporters have been prosecuted under the Espionage Act. How do you think the Roberts Court would respond if the Department of Justice were to pursue a reporter for disclosing classified information in a news story? And what do you think is the future of leak investigations and reporters' privilege?
Well, I think the biggest hope there is that the president speaks about it. I think we've already seen examples in which the things he said are so over the top legally that it significantly harms the chances of the Department of Justice to prevail. But that said, I'm very concerned about both the areas that you identify. I do think that an Espionage Act prosecution of a journalist for reportage is one in which I would say the journalist is more likely than not to win, but certainly can't say with any confidence.
But that's for actual publication of truthful information.
Yes. I'm coming to leaks in a moment. But even publication is not a closed case by any means. In terms of leaks, I think the journalists are at very great risk in front of the Roberts Court. I think that's one of the softest spots in terms of potential for great harm to journalists. And what I said at the beginning really could come into play in that sort of case, because it would not surprise me if the administration, in the course of that sort of case, wound up so denouncing the journalists in such extravagant terms that it might even wind up helping and persuading the court that this is not just a leak case, this is an effort to get the press. But viewing it narrowly as a leak case in terms of what the law is now, the unlikelihood now of a federal shield law being adopted, it's an area of very great concern.
So whatever Justice Powell's concurrence in Brandsburg meant, it did say you can't be harassing journalists.
Yeah.
Maybe that's how that comes out. Is there a question back there?
Yeah. I'm curious what your First Amendment interpretation is of two different kinds of regulations on opposite sides of the political spectrum in the abortion context. The first being the regulation of crisis pregnancy centers. For example, the Act in California that requires crisis pregnancy centers to have a poster stating that people working there lack any sort of medical license and therefore can't mislead patients who are there to get abortion or contraceptive services. And then on the other side of the spectrum, laws requiring doctors to provide ultrasound to women seeking abortions, and in some cases actually narrate what's happening in that ultrasound and force patients to view the picture.
I'm going to take a stab at paraphrasing that. Two different kinds of abortion regulations with free speech overtones. One, crisis pregnancy centers being required to post notices or say that they don't have anyone with a medical license, and laws that require doctors to perform ultrasounds on women seeking abortion and to narrate what they see. What kind of First Amendment implications do you see there, Floyd?
Well, I see First Amendment implications in both of them, but I think you wanted more than that. The court has been strong in protecting against compulsory speech in a variety of circumstances. And the second example that you pick, requiring the doctor to say I think would raise a serious First Amendment flags, even for members of the court who are disenchanted with or never would have signed on to Roe versus Wade. I don't think that the court would say there was a First Amendment issue in terms of requiring ultrasound examination of this sort or that sort. As I say, I think the strongest First Amendment issue from the court's perspective would be when you start requiring certain types of speech. It's almost as if it's easier to get sustained, it's counterintuitive to say this, but easier to get sustained barring doctors from saying something supportive about having an abortion than it is to require them to say something in that area, such as you posited. Both are very live, open issues for the future.
Linda Greenhouse.
Yes, so that case that she mentioned was not hypothetical. That was a Fourth Circuit decision that struck down the doctor who compelled speech on person that was going to certainly deny. So I guess we'll see what happens next. But I have a different reality-based hypothetical. There's a Vermont law on patient choice at the end of life law that gives terminally ill patients the right to information from a doctor about all their options for end-of-life treatment, including self-administered lethal drugs, and says that if doctors have a conscience-based objection to providing this information, their only obligation is to refer the patient to a doctor who will give the patient the information. The state has been sued by a Christian doctors group who say that even the referral obligation makes them complicit in the sin of suicide. And if this law were to be enforced, they would have to give up their medical licenses from the state of Vermont. That complaint has been filed, it's pending in the U.S. District Court in Vermont, and I just wonder what you think of.
Is that under a state referral?
It's just under First Amendment compelled speech and free exercise.
But this is a Vermont statutory requirement.
Are you reminded of the questions, or shall I try to rephrase them?
It's a good idea to rephrase them.
Okay, I'll do my best. So apparently there's a Vermont law that requires doctors faced with patients seeking end-of-life choices to give them various information. But doctors with religious objections, the law says, need only refer the patient to someone else who can give them that range of choices because the doctor may not himself or herself want to do that. This law has been challenged on the ground. It sounds a little like the Little Sisters of the Poor case, on the ground that even that referral makes the doctor complicit in sin, and now we'll have Floyd's analysis.
Well, I think it is so similar to the Little Sisters case that, trying to predict what the court would do with it. I think it begins outside the First Amendment area. The context is not a traditional speech area or a speech issue, but it is a speech. It does raise a serious religious freedom, at least, question. I think the court would be sympathetic to what they would view as the plight of the doctor who in good faith believes that he/she could not be a part of the process set forth in the statute. I think, you know, there are very, so long as it is religiously based, that I think they certainly would say that certainly implicates the First Amendment. But I think that chances are better than even that they might well sustain the objection to it on behalf of the offended doctor.
Anyone else in New York?
Yes.
I see a hand.
In your view of the First Amendment, does the press clause have independent meaning and content as relates to, as compared to the speech clause? And if so, what would that be, and what would its scope be?
Well, I have to answer that. And, you know, when people ask constitutional questions of anyone, they're really, the audience is entitled to know the difference between what the person addressed thinks the First Amendment means and what the person addressed thinks the Supreme Court will do in the case. And I think very often people don't make that distinction. Yes, I have thought that the press clause had a level of independent meaning, and that for no other reason than that generally don't read out of the Constitution language that is in there and just say it's nugatory or it's repetitive, etc. And I have thought that the press clause could help in source cases, maybe in access cases and the like, because of the unique role played by the press. That said, with the development of the internet and the everybody's a publisher theme of that, because of the definitional difficulties of who is a journalist, which do become more difficult by the moment sometimes, and because of the reluctance of this court, I think, to afford a genuinely independent meaning to whether one said it's the press clause or to the press, even with or without the press clause, the way that would be couched by Justice Alito, for example, is saying, you know, we get more rights than you because of who we are, as opposed to what we do, etc. I think the direction of this court is clearly one towards a very expansive reading of the free speech clause and a very narrow reading, if at all, of the press clause. And I think it's more likely than not the press clause is going to be read as the free speech clause is applied to the press, which is to say that it has no independent meaning. A journalist wouldn't need it. And again, the area where I think that could help, could have helped, but I don't think with this court that they're there, is in areas in which journalists in particular need the special protections in confidential sources, for example. I mean, we don't live and we will never live in a society in which every secret told by one person to another, even for dissemination to a broader group, is going to be well protected. But I just don't think the court is ready to go to a level of protection of the press, qua press, and I think they think they are very protective of free expression generally, and that the press ought to be grateful for that.
put aside the Supreme Court for a second, Floyd. Do you think the press clause protects a set of businesses, or do you think it protects a mode of communication?
Or an activity.
Yeah, I think it should be viewed as an activity. I mean, look, I've always thought that for some time I thought that the analogy to to what we do with respect to religion is a strong one, and that is to say, the courts never get involved in deciding what is a religion or not. What they in deciding, let's say, the common law for statutory privilege of the priest penitent privilege. What they do is to look and say, is this the sort of thing that religious organizations and entities historically have done? Communication in private for spiritual or other solace or advice or the like, and not winding up saying, therefore, it's religion, but winding up saying that this is the stuff of priest penitent. And I've always thought that you could do the same thing with respect to journalists without having a binding definition of what is a journalist. You know, and there's someone on the internet who promises confidentiality in the course of what the person does for the broader purpose of getting information to disseminate to the public, and other factors would come into play as well, you know, could be deemed protected by the press clause in much the same way that various internet-only publications have been held protected by the press, or protected as if that they were paper issuance and reportage entities. But, at least for the moment, I don't think the courts are comfortable there. I do think the answer to the question has to be it's activity focused. I don't think that it can be, well, it has to be for profit. It can't be that. It can't be just a business. So what you're throwing out the ACLU newsletter, none of that's going to work. So there's a lot for law students still to do in the future.
So when we run out of time, this is the book, really terrific. You should seek it out, and please join me in thanking Floyd for his first attempt.